talking about what is church. What is church? And as a result of this pandemic crisis and where the nation has been shut down and churches shut down, I think a lot of people have had to maybe rethink, what is church? Church must be more than a building. Church must be more than a program. And yes, it is. And the only way we can find out what church really is to go to the Bible, go to Jesus. Jesus is the one who founded the church. For as the scripture we elaborated on last week, in Matthew chapter 14, I believe it's verse 16, where Jesus said, "I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it." That's the church I belong to. That's the church I trust you belong to through your faith in Jesus Christ. Now, I want to reiterate today just a couple of things that we said last week to keep in front of you. But first, let's just pray. Let's invite the Holy Spirit, who is the ultimate teacher, who is the ultimate revelator of God's Word, who will give us understanding. Let's invite Him. Let's pray. Let's invite the Holy Spirit. Lord, we thank You today. Oh, Lord, we thank You for people who have gathered together with us from so many different places. And we thank You, Lord, for Your Holy Spirit that You have given to Your people. And we welcome You, Holy Spirit. We invite You. We plead with You, Holy Spirit. Give us understanding. Pierce our hearts. Pierce our minds with Your presence and with Your light and Your illumination. We pray and we ask it, oh God, in the mighty name of Jesus. And we thank You for it, Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, I want to mention this, reiterate, the word church is translated from the Greek word ecclesia. Ecclesia. Ecclesia is made up of two words, a prefix, ek, meaning out of, and kaleo, meaning to call. So literally, the word means to be called out, to be called out. And so there we have a sense of the word church. It is a people who have been called out. My friends, you have been called out. When you felt that drawing and that urge in your heart to come to Jesus, to give your life to Him, that was the Holy Spirit calling you out. Calling you out from your former life. Calling you out to a new life that is lived in Jesus Christ. There's a passage in, I believe it is the book of Numbers, and I did not previously look this up, but I know it is there. And it is a prophecy. It is a messianic prophecy about the coming of the Messiah. And it has this statement. It says, "And unto him shall the gathering of the people be." Now, this is such an important understanding of the word church. Ecclesia, to be called out. And this Old Testament messianic prophecy said that unto him, unto the Messiah, unto him shall the gathering of the people be. Not only is he the builder of this people, not only is he the one who is gathering this people, but he is the one to whom the people are being gathered. Oh, I thank God for all the churches. I thank God for all the pastors and all the good churches and all the good pastors. But my friends, we are not being called to a church. We are not being called to a preacher. We haven't been called to the Pope or any other individual or religious person. We are being called unto Him. Unto Him shall the gathering of the people be. You have been called unto Jesus Christ Himself. There's a passage in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I think it's probably around verse 16, 17. It says that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto Himself. Reconciling the world unto Himself. That the church world today has no understanding, has little understanding of what church really is indicated by the fact, I challenge you to try it. You ask somebody, you know they're Christian. You ask them, are you a Christian? And they'll immediately tell you what church or denomination they belong to. Are you a Christian? Oh, yes, I'm a Baptist. Are you a Christian? Oh, yes, I'm Assemblies of God. Oh, yes, I'm a Presbyterian. No. That's not what makes you a Christian, a true Christian. That's not what makes you a part of the ecclesia of God. You have been called unto Him. You have been called unto Christ Himself. You belong to Him. I pointed out last week that the first English translations of the Bible, there were several English translations of the Bible before the King James Version. The first one was the Tyndale Bible. I believe the New Testament was first published, I believe, in 1526. I know it's in the notes from last week. And then after that, there was the Coverdale Bible, which was around 1534, 1535. Then there was called the Great Bible. And what's interesting, none of these three early translations have the English word church in them. They do not contain the word church. And there was a reason for that. Now, when it came to ecclesia, instead of using the word church, they used the word assembly, or they used the word congregation. Why did they do that? Because they were reformers. And the church, by this time, after 1,500 years, had become identified with great cathedrals and buildings and a hierarchical priesthood and certain liturgy and religious rituals. And they knew that is not church. And they did not want to communicate that that was what the ecclesia is, that the Greek word that is used. So they avoided using it, and they would translate the word ecclesia with assembly or congregation. My friends, we are the called out ones. We are being gathered together unto Him. And as I mentioned last week, there are three, you know, we could probably pull out more, but there are three major images in the New Testament that Paul particularly uses to communicate a picture and idea of what is meant by the ecclesia of God. And those three images are the people of God, the church as the people of God, the church as the body of Christ, and the church as the temple or the sanctuary of God. Last Tuesday, we dealt with church as the people of God. And oh, I hope if you haven't heard that teaching, it's there on the God's Word to Women channel. I urge you to go and listen to that. There was great insight that came forth. I sensed it flowing forth as I was teaching. So go back and listen to that lesson about church as the people of God. I think on the channel, it is called The Glorious Ecclesia, Church of Jesus Christ. The Glorious Ecclesia, Church of Jesus Christ. Now, today I want to go ahead and get into the church as the body of Christ. There are different places where Paul talks about church as the body of Christ. He talks about it in his letter to the Ephesians. He talks about it in Romans chapter 12. He talks about it in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Now, in the manual, I don't know, some of you have the manual, and if you do, I'm going to go over to page 61 in the manual, Think Biblically. The manual, Think Biblically, which is the primary source from which we are teaching, and I'll hold it up where you can see it, Think Biblically. It's available in our bookstore at eddiehyatt.com. But what is it that Paul wants to communicate through presenting the church as the body of Christ? You know, you have a body through which you function. The body is not you per se. Because we see from scriptures that when a believer dies, they depart. Their spirit and their soul, the real you departs and goes to be with Christ. The body is put in the ground. The body is your earth suit. It gives you the ability to function and communicate here on earth to other physical beings. Jesus Christ, God Almighty, came to earth. God, who is spirit, took on human form in the person of Jesus of Nazareth. And he lived on this earth for about 33 and a half years, and he ministered for approximately 3 years. And then he died for the sins of the world. He rose from the dead. He ascended to the right hand of God, and from whence he poured out the gift of the Holy Spirit, which is his own Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, he is there. The Holy Spirit is called the Spirit of God. The Holy Spirit is called the Spirit of Christ. The Holy Spirit is called the Spirit of Jesus, different places in Scripture. And so Jesus now, the fact that the church is called the body of Christ, that physical body that was resurrected that still has the wounds in his hands, in his feet, on his brow, that body is seated at the right hand of God in heaven, at the pinnacle of the universe with all power in heaven and earth. But now he has another body to which he has given his Holy Spirit, that his Holy Spirit works through to carry out his plans, his purposes, to communicate his heart and his mind to this world. And this is called the body of Christ. Now, it is a metaphor. It is an image. It is a picture to help us understand who we are as the church of the living God, as the ecclesia of the living God. We are the body of the risen Christ. The church, I'll read what I have here in the manual, page 61. Number one, at the bottom of the page, the church as the body of Christ expresses the concept of the church as the instrument or channel through which Christ expresses himself and carries out his purpose. You and I are his hands. We are his feet. We are his mouthpiece. We are his instruments through whom he works to carry out, to advance his plan, to advance his cause, to communicate his message to this world. Oh, what an incredible privilege, but also what an incredible responsibility we have as the body of Christ, as the instrument through which he communicates himself to this world. Number two, boy, I got a sila there. Need to stop and think about that. God does not send angels to communicate who he is to people. Do you remember there was a Roman? He was not saved. It seems that he was a God-fearer, that he had been exposed to the Jewish message of one God, and he had embraced that. But his heart was hungry, and he was fasting, and he was praying. And an angel appeared to him. And the angel didn't tell him the gospel message. The angel did not communicate to him what he needed to know. The angel could not tell him what he needed to know to be saved. But he told him where to send to get somebody who could tell him. He said, told him to send to the city of Joppa, to the house of a man called Simon the Tanner. And he said, in his house, there's an individual by the name of Peter, and he's praying, and he has seen a vision. And he will tell you how you and all of your household can be saved. Oh, the wonderful privilege of communicating to this world that Jesus saves has been given to men and women, boys and girls, human beings, not to angels. You and I are the body of Christ. We have the responsibility. We have the privilege of communicating who he is. We are his hands. We are his feet. We are His mouthpiece. Oh, may we take this responsibility and this privilege seriously and prepare our hearts through prayer and the study of the Word of God to truly be His body, communicating His heart, His mind, His words to this world in which we live. I remember, I'll go ahead and tell this. I remember many years ago, before I ever went to Bible school, before I ever went met Sue, there was an individual who lived, you know, this is a rural area in Northeast Texas, Shikota, Texas. There's, I don't even know if there's a store there anymore, but at this time, I believe there was one store, probably one store, one post office, and just one highway that went through. But there were people that lived around, scattered around. And there was an individual who moved, and we knew this person already. My parents had known him from many years ago. I still remember his name was Ari Jeffries. He had a sister named Mary Jeffries, who was a very powerful preacher and evangelist. And her brother Ari, who was single, I think maybe he had probably divorced or whatever, I don't know, but he was single. He was probably, I'm going to guess, he was probably 60 years old. And he lived probably 200 yards from our house, and he had had a stroke, and one side was paralyzed, and he had a brace on one side all up and down from his hip down, and he walked with a crutch, and he could not articulate his words. He could only make sound, And he would, when he couldn't drive, so when he needed to go someplace, he would hobble over to our house, and he would make motions, and we say, do you want to go to the store? Do you need to go into town? You need to go to the grocery store? You need to go to the pharmacy? So we would have to ask questions and to find out what he wanted from us and how we could help him, because he was the same person. He was the same Ari Jeffries. He had the same feelings, the same desires, the same aspirations, the same concerns, but he had a body that was paralyzed, and he could not communicate adequately through that body. And I can still remember that one time he came down to our house, and he was saying, and we were asking him question after question. Do you need to go here? Do you want us to do this? And he went on, and I don't know, this went on for some time, and finally, in total exasperation, He made a motion like this of total frustration, and he turned around and hobbled off and went home. How frustrated it must have been to have all these thoughts and desires, but not to be able to communicate it. My friends, Jesus Christ needs a healthy body on this earth through which to clearly communicate His heart and His desires. And one reason the Great Commission has not been fulfilled, one reason that the earth has continued in degradation and sin and evil and so much pain, is because Jesus Christ has not had a strong, healthy body through which He can communicate His heart, His mind, His thoughts, and His words to a generation. Oh, may we be that generation. May we be the people. May we be a functioning body through which Jesus Christ can clearly and articulately communicate His heart, His mind, His words to this generation. Hallelujah. Oh, my friends, we're the body of Christ. We're the body of Christ. Yeah, we're individual members. We'll get to that. But as individual members, may we be a healthy individual member fulfilling our function and our purpose, so that we will be a healthy body, a strong body. And it's not about communicating who we are. It's about so that He can communicate through us who He is and what His heart and His desires and His message for this world. I just got to stop there and just take a moment and say, Lord, we thank You today for the wonderful privilege And the incredible responsibility of being the body of Christ, of being that vehicle through which you will communicate yourself to this world in which we live. Thank you, O God, and may we live up to that calling. And we know that we can only do it through the power of your Holy Spirit. So, Lord, come visit us today. Heal us, empower us with your Spirit and your presence, we pray, in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for it, Lord. Praise you in Jesus' name.
Yes, in that Sue. You've paused, there's a thought that has been going through my mind as you've been sharing this part.
Yes, Sue.
It has to do with that we are dead, yet alive in Him.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. In order for Him to live through us, we have to be dead to self.
Right. Good point.
That's not taught. That's not taught today.
Right.
But it's so, so important. I think that's where the sila might be coming in, where the stop and think about this. Just meditate on this for a minute. In this day when since the late 60s into the 70s, psychology came into the church as I'm okay, you're okay, we must be healed to possess the land.
Very me-centered.
To possess the land. We have to go through inner healing and
deliverance.
And there's a whole calendar or list of things that psychology brought into the church. You know, Jesus was God on earth. He was Emmanuel, God with us. So if He had taught all of these things that psychology is teaching, I mean, He could have taught those things had they been part of His message.
Right.
But it seems that they weren't.
Yeah.
And so, whereas psychology has emphasized that we're to be whole, we're to be healed, we're to be delivered from our past, I maintain that our past has helped to shape us, that all things work together for good to those who are called according to His purpose. So I think we need to get back to what the Bible really teaches about who we are in Him. And a big part of that, as much as we don't like to hear this, is you've been crucified with Christ nevertheless.
But, and this,
it's
this,
not I who lives, it's Christ who lives through me.
Right.
And you can't have two beings contending. He's the one who wants to express Himself through us.
True. Yes.
There's a truth there. I know I'm not getting it through
the way it needs to,
but it's very, very, very basic and important.
Yeah, and it's what Jesus said in His call to discipleship. He said, whoever tries to save his life
or her life
will lose it.
Yeah.
But whoever loses their life for my sake in the gospel will find life. Wow.
Incredible.
That's what you're saying.
It's incredible.
And Jesus said, to find real meaning, to find why you're here on earth. And it's so true. Where else could we find our meaning except through the Creator? And so here are we, all these little people down here on the earth. We're just trying to get the most we can out of this life apart from the... No. It's a futile thing. And Jesus, His call to disciples, you let go of your life. If you try to save your life, you'll lose it. But if you lose your life for my sake and the gospel, oh, you will find life in me. Wow. Hey, Pat Joyce out in West Texas with us, Pat. So glad you're with us this morning. Ellen Capozzi, Boston with us. Karen Jean Matheson, way up in Oregon. Hey, so we're thankful for everybody on. And Karen says, well said, Susan. Yes, that's a part of becoming the body of Christ. We find our meaning in Him. And another thing, Sue, related to this God's Word to Women and the International Christian Women's Hall of Fame. The body of Christ has been paralyzed by bad theology concerning the female members of the body of Christ. Think about this, my friends. Remember my little story of our friend Irie who couldn't communicate? Well, think about this. The female members of Christ's body throughout Christian history have been paralyzed by bad theology that said, no, you can't teach, you can't lead, you can't do this, you can't do that because of your sex, because you're a woman. You can't do this. You can't get up and preach. You can't pastor. You can't teach. You can't do this. And bad theology has paralyzed the body of Christ. And Jesus has not been able to fully function and reveal and communicate himself through this paralyzed body, paralyzed by bad theology. Wrong doctrine. My friends, this is why we have right here, our little group right here, we have a world significant mandate. I'll say that again. We have a world significant mandate. God's entrusted to us a message. I know there's other people preaching and teaching it too. But I know that we have a special mandate with a message that is designed to free up the body of Christ and to free up the members of the body of Christ so that Christ can have a functioning body through which to function and to reveal himself in this present world. Number two in the outline at the top of the page, we're talking about the body of Christ, what it means that we are the body of Christ. Talking about church, what is church? And this is one of the images in the New Testament to help us to understand what is church. The church as the body of Christ expresses the intimate union of the believer, both individually and corporately, with Christ, who is said to be the head of the church. Now, I want to go turn over and read that in Ephesians chapter 1. And by the way, some of you, you may not realize this, but this is the word kephale. And Paul in Ephesians 1, starting at verse 18, he's telling about the resurrection of Christ and the incredible thing that God has done for us in Jesus Christ. And talks about how that he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places. Listen to this, far above. Oh, my! If anybody here is weighted down with wrong teachings about spiritual warfare, yes, I believe in spiritual warfare. We're engaged in spiritual warfare. But what I am against is this teaching that would almost put God and the devil on the same level, with the devil just a little bit below God. No, my friends, that is not how it's happening. The devil is a completely defeated foe. And this is expressed here where it says that when he was raised from the dead, God seated him at his own right hand far above. Jesus far above all principality, all power, all mighty dominion, and every name that is named in the earth that is in to come. And Paul holds point here, and I don't want to get distracted on a whole nother teaching, but Paul's point here is that the same power, that incredible, I believe the greatest demonstration of power the universe has ever known, when God raised Jesus from the dead, brought him out of the tomb, defeated Satan, defeated sin, and raised him up to the right hand of God with all authority in heaven and earth. Paul says that same power that was at work bringing Jesus out of the tomb is the same power that God has put in you, a believer in Christ. But he goes on and says, verse 22, and he put all things under his, that's Jesus Christ, under his feet, and gave him to be head over all things to the church. Now the Greek word there is head, and the word kephale, when it is used figuratively, now this is the word kephale for head, and it's used in the Bible most of the time. In the New Testament, it's referring to somebody's physical head. When they cut off John the Baptist's head, the biblical writers use the word kephale. They cut off John the Baptist's kephale, literal head. But when it is used figuratively, it is almost always used in the sense as being the source or the origin of something, the source of life. And when it talks about Jesus being the head of the church, it's talking about him being the source of the life of the church. Yes, he is the Lord of the church. He is the master of the church. And words, those words are used in other places, but when those times he's spoken of as the kephale of the church, it is to emphasize that he is the source of life for the church, and every member of the body must look to him as the source for their life and their function in this body of Christ. And Pat Joy said, Sue, that was anointed. Thanks. Okay. And Sean and Margaret, our Irish family, are on from Ballinasloe, Ireland. And I haven't heard from Carmel, but I suspect Carmel in Athlone, Ireland is on with us today. Hey, so thankful for all of you. Hey, we are the body of Christ and we are connected regardless of geography of space. We're connected in the spirit. And thank God we're connected with modern technology here today. And he put all things under his feet and gave him to be head, kephale, over all things to the church. Gave him to be the head, the source of life for all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. All he is saying here is that we have received of his fullness. Paul expresses this in different places. Colossians 2:10, he says that in him dwells all the fullness, wow, of the Godhead body. In Christ dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Isn't that amazing? I got to say that again. In Jesus Christ dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And in the very next words, Paul says, and you are complete in him. And then let me read a passage over in the Gospel of John. John chapter 1. Listen to this. This is powerful stuff, my friends. John 1:16, John said, and of his fullness. What did Paul say? In him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And of his fullness we have all received, and grace for grace. For the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Jesus has, out of his fullness, because we're his body, he's filling us out of his fullness. That is what the scripture is saying. He is our source. Your source is not a religious institution. Your source is not a denomination. Your source is not Eddie Hyatt or Sue Hyatt or any other preacher or pope or anybody. Your source, your ultimate source, is Jesus Christ. There was a problem in Colossians, and Paul wrote them a letter and he warned them that they had become disconnected from their source because they were putting their attention on other spiritual things rather than on Christ himself. They had become preoccupied with angels and other forms of spirituality that are real, but they are not our source. We don't look to them. There is one source, Jesus Christ, in whom dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. I believe in angels. Hey, I believe they're around me all the time protecting me. But when I realize that Almighty God, the sovereign Lord of the universe, has come down and reconciled me to himself, and out of his fullness, he has filled me with his own life out of his fullness and drawn me into a fellowship and relationship with him. Ever since then, I can't get excited about a puny little angel. Oh, thank you, Lord. Colossians chapter 2, verse 18. Let no one cheat you of your reward, taking delight in false humility and worship of angels. That word worship is the Greek word threskia. It is not the normal word for worship. When it talks about worship of God, it is found only here and two other places, and each time it's translated as religion. And what seems to be the problem, one of the problems in Colossae, is that they had developed a religious fascination with angels, an unhealthy religious fascination with angels, which some people are doing this very same thing today in the world and even in the charismatic movement. The Colossians had developed a threskia, an unhealthy religious fascination with angels, and it was serious. Intruding into these things, he is seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind. Notice this, for here's the problem, verse 19. And not holding fast to the head, to the kephale, talking about Christ. You've become fascinated with all these other things that are real, but they're not your source. They're not what's ultimately important. And because you've become so fascinated with these things and preoccupied with these things, you have become disconnected from your source. And that's exactly how the NIV translates it. As I turn over, I want you to hear it in the NIV. It just brings it together in such a real way. NIV, Colossians 2, 18 and 19. Do not let anyone who delights in false humility and the worship of angels, the threskey of angels, the preoccupation with angels, disqualify you. Such a person goes into great detail about what they have seen. They are puffed up with idle notions by their unspiritual mind. Listen to this. They have lost connection with the head, from whom the whole body, supported and held together by its ligaments and sinews, grows as God causes it to grow. We must never allow anything to disconnect us from the head. And Sue, that is the reason in 1998, when you published, your book was at the printer in 1998, In the Spirit We're Equal, and this message was alive. You knew that God had put it on your heart and that He had given you a commission. And we were with Bill and Melinda Fish in the Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania area, Trafford, Pennsylvania. And there was a meeting. It was a very wild meeting. And people were lying on the floor and, you know, I don't know. But anyway, you were sitting on the floor with your back against the wall. And this message was so real in your heart and mind. I was the one who they'd asked me to speak. I'd spoken that night. But this is what was consuming your mind and your thoughts, was this message of biblical equality. And as you were sitting there, God spoke to you and said, the cause is not the call. Now feel free, Sue, to, if you want to comment, the cause is not the call. And you had to think on that and even ask God, what are you talking about? And God made it very clear to you, Sue, I've given you a commission. I've given you a cause. But this cause must never cause you to become disconnected from me. Because your call is to be connected with me. Your call is to know me. Is to be always connected with me, because I am the source of your life. I am the source of all that you are and ever will be. And you must never allow an assignment I give you become a cause that consumes you and takes you away from me. Hallelujah. All that happened, my friends, I'm afraid that happens. And talking about it, I feel a weeping inside that this has happened throughout church history, happens today, that all kinds of good causes becomes the driving, consuming passion in people's lives, and disconnects them from the source of our life.
Even your call concerning the nations and so on, you have to be
careful. Oh, sure, absolutely, absolutely. We all have to, yes. And so every time it talks about the church as the body of Christ, it's talking about our intimate connection, union, fellowship with Christ Himself. We're His body. We are intimately joined to Him. A quote from a well-known scholar, F.F. Bruce, the late F.F. Bruce, very well-known British scholar. He's talking about the use of the word head, Jesus being the head of the body. He says the organic relation. In other words, it's just not a doctrinal, mechanical thing. This is real. By the Holy Spirit, this is a real union between us and our head, our Lord Jesus Christ. He says the organic relation between head and body suggests the vital union between Christ and the church, shares of a common life, which is His own risen life, communicated to His people. Yes, as the head, as the source, and we're His body, He is communicating in us and through us His own resurrection life. I remember when the disciples were imprisoned, but an angel appeared and opened the prison doors and said to them, go stand in the temple and speak to the people all the words of this life. Oh, my friends, we have words of life to speak to people. When you put your faith in Jesus Christ, you were joined to Him. You were reconciled to Him. You were joined to Him. And He began to pour into you His own very life. And it is that life, which is the Holy Spirit, that gives each member our function in this body. And this is where I want to go to next. The church as the body of Christ, number three, expresses the idea that every member of the body is important and each member's function is necessary for the health and proper functioning of the body as a whole. And the reason I'm laughing when I read this, I was remembering something, but let me read that again. The idea that we're the body of the Christ, many members, but just one body, expresses the idea that every member is important. It was probably within the first few months of Sue and I's marriage, and we went back to her home area of New Brunswick, Canada, and there were some people who were gone on vacation, and they asked us to, invited us to look after their house, to stay in their house. It was out in the country. And, you know, they had a garden and so on, and they had a tiller, and I decided to plow their garden for them. But not being used to the area, I was moving kind of fast in the house, and I hit my little toe on a bed post. And man, I mean, I hit it hard. It was bruised and swelled. But I didn't think my little toe would have any bearing on me tilling their garden. So I got out, I started the tiller, and I started going. But man, when I would step on that foot and try to push, I mean, the pain would shoot through that toe. I couldn't do it. I had to give up the job of tilling the garden because of a little toe that was out of order. My friends, every member of the body, you may feel like you're a little toe. Well, function, be the best you can as a little toe. Be a healthy, functioning little toe, for who knows how important you are to the functioning of the body of Christ. The church as the body of Christ expresses the diversity within unity in the body of Christ. That is to say, the body consists of many different members with many different functions cooperating in only one body. My friends, we are all different. When God made you, He threw away the mold and said, I'll not make another one of those. We are all different. And in the body, we're not dependent on one another. We are not independent of one another, but we are interdependent. We have one source, and the one source flows through us, but then in relation to one another, we are interdependent. And I thought of this in relation, I was reading the story of Elijah that I felt illustrated this. When Elijah had prayed that it would not rain, and he announced to Ahab that it wasn't going to rain, he said, according to my word. And then God spoke to him and told him to go down by the brook Cherith and stay there. And there he would drink from the brook, and the ravens would feed him. So he was totally dependent on God. So he obeyed and he went down. And sure enough, the ravens fed him, and he drank from the brook. But one day the brook dried up as a result of Elijah's own prayers, because Elijah had prayed that it wouldn't rain. So his own prayers dried up the brook he was drinking from. But then God spoke to him and said, I want you to go down, because God's his source, go down to the city of Zarephath, because I have commanded a widow there to feed you. Now, there's so much we could say about that, but I just want to just say enough to make my point. So he went down. There was an interdependence. He went down. He found this woman. She had enough oil and meal to make one meal for her and her son. She said, and then we're going to die, because the famine that Elijah had prayed into existence, the famine was affecting, had affected her. And Elijah said, well, make me one first. And then he spoke forth a word from God, said, because thus saith the Lord, your meal will not drop, and so on. So she made one for Elijah. He ate, and then she made for her son. And then the scripture says that they ate for many days there together. There was an interdependence between them. And there is an interdependence between the members of the body of Christ. Yes, Christ is the source for all of us. And he is the ultimate source, and we're to all be dependent upon him. But then there is a healthy interdependence upon one another, that as we all fulfill our function in the body of Christ, you supply what I need, I supply what you need, and there is a flowing back and forth, an interdependence. And when that is functioning in a healthy way, every need will be met. And it will be like in the early church. The Bible says there was such a free flowing among the people. The Bible says there in the early, one of the early chapters of Acts, I think it may be at the end of Acts chapter 4, it says, neither was there any one among them who lacked. Wow. Because we all have been given different gifts, different abilities. And as we are free to give of what we have and flow back and forth, every need will be met. Hallelujah. Number five, the church as the body of Christ expresses the absolute necessity of giving preeminence to the directives and guidance of the Holy Spirit. Since only the Holy Spirit can give life and empower the church to function as a body. And here's an interesting thing. Each time Paul shares the concept of the church as the body of Christ, that concept is expressed within the context of the spiritual gifts. Do you hear that? Each time he expresses the concept of the church as the body of Christ, he expresses it in the concept in a discussion of spiritual gifts. Or you could put it, say it the other way. Every time he discusses spiritual gifts, he discusses spiritual gifts in the context of the church being the body of Christ. Why? Because it is the Holy Spirit that causes us to be a functioning body. It is the Holy Spirit who imparts to you your unique gift, to your unique personality. And 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 10 says, as every person has received a charismata, a spiritual gift, minister it to one another as good stewards of the grace of Christ. Now, one problem is in traditional church, there's, and of course, well, let me just say it. I'll just say it and then we'll move on. Traditional church, a professionalized ministry, we have a few people who are up front on a platform who are ministering. And we have a multitude of people sitting in the seats who are spectators. That is not a functioning body. That is an entertainment center. And what God is wanting, yeah, there's a place for all of that. I'm not saying there's no place for that, but I'm saying that is not church. Church is a functioning body. In fact, in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 16, and I'll close by reading verse 16, Ephesians chapter 4, it talks about the purpose of leadership gifts, the apostle, the prophet, the evangelist, the pastor, and teacher, that the purpose of these gifts is not to reach the world, but it is to minister to Christ's body for the preparing of the saints, for the equipping of the saints. Oh, my goodness. Do you hear that? The leadership callings, gifts and callings, are not for the purpose of reaching the world. It is for preparing the body of Christ. It's for equipping the saints. It's for helping each member of the body to become a healthy, functioning member, contributing its gift, its place, its calling in the body of Christ. Ephesians chapter 4, we'll close with this. Verse 11. And it's in the context of the ascended Christ, the ascended Lord, out of His fullness. It says, and He gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers. Why? Here you're going to tell why. This is very interesting. For the equipping of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Now, I've got to put this in there. There are three fours in my English translation. The first two are the same in Greek, but the third is a different Greek word. Let me just mention this. This is so important. The first two fours, for the equipping of the ministry, is pros. And it means it for, because of, or for. But the last four is ace, into. In other words, it gives the ultimate purpose of all this, into the building up of the body of Christ. And He gave these ascension gifts, these ministry gifts. Why? For the equipping of the saints, into the work of the ministry, into the building up of the body of Christ. I'm sorry. The second two are the same. Ace, into. And I'm going to clarify this later. But it's coming back to me as I'm saying this. For, here's why they're there. For the equipping of the saints, which then will lead into the work of the ministry. Who's going to do the work of the ministry? The saints, the body of Christ, will do the work of the ministry into the building up of the body of Christ. This is what's going to happen when the saints are equipped and prepared, when there is a living, functioning body of Jesus Christ in the earth. Verse 13, till we all come to the unity of the faith and to the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we should no longer be children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine. All that's happening so much today by the trickery of men in the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting. Oh, but here's where we should be. But speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things unto Him who is the head. So we are to grow up into Him, not grow up into apostle so-and-so or prophet so-and-so. No, 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 no. We're to grow up into Christ. He is our source. He is the goal. He is the one we are reaching for. That we should no longer be children and so on. But speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things into Him who is the head, Christ. Listen to this. From whom the whole body, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies. Now, it's from him that the whole body is joined together. But then each part supplies something out of what he gives to each member. Then each member supplies to other members. And there's a flowing back and forth that binds the body together and meets the need of every part of the body. And knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. Oh, when the church is functioning as a healthy body, there is an organic growth that rises up from within. Hallelujah. It causes growth of the body for the edifying, for the building up of itself in love. Oh, there's so much more we could say and talk about, but we're going to stop there. And let's just pause for a moment and let's pray. Oh, God. Oh, kilama sondre bi kishi andalabo sondra ma kisandalabo sul. Oh, hallelujah to God. Hallelujah to God. Lord, we thank you and we praise you today. We bless and honor your name, Lord. Lord, what a privilege it is to be the body of Christ. What a privilege it is to be a member of Christ's body in the earth. Lord, even if we are what seems like a small, insignificant member, but yet every member partakes of his own life, of his own resurrection life, and every member is intimately joined to him, the head. Lord, I pray for every person watching today. And I know there are people, they feel like a round peg trying to fit into a square hole. I pray that every person today, Lord, will relax and rest in you. Focus on their connection with you. Because, Lord, you are the one. It all starts with you flowing into us and then causing us to be knit together and joined together. So, Lord, I just pray that you'll help every person today, those who are struggling with where they fit. I talk to so many people, just, you know, they just feel like they don't fit. That's okay. Just make sure you fit with Jesus. And then he... Oh, kilama sondre bikishi. Yes, he will cause you to fit with people. Hey, it may be through the internet. It may be with church where you are. Coming to you from Grapevine, Texas. I don't know. I'm not going to assume. But I am so thankful for the people out there that God has connected you with us. You're part of our lives. We have a world significant mission to take on that God has given us. He is our source. And we're thankful for all of you, friends, partners, and everyone who's a part of our lives who pray for us, encourage us. We're thankful for you. And let's just pray for the body of Christ. How would you go about facilitating a fully functioning body of Christ? Margaret, thanks for asking that, you know, because I had a story I was going to tell, but I felt not to tell it, and I think this may be where I tell it. First of all, it has to start with Jesus. It can't be about joining a group, joining a institution called church and so on. It has to be, there's got to be a call for people to come to him. That Old Testament prophecy in Numbers, unto him shall the gathering, the people be. We've all got to be intimately joined with him and living in that intimate fellowship with him. That's where it's got to start. But let me tell you a little story that I learned that I think will add something to this many years ago. This was in probably the first couple of years of our marriage, so it's been well over 40 years ago. And we had gone back to where Sue had grown up. Of course, I'm from Texas, so this is all new to me. I'm getting to know people up there. And we became part of a church, and they asked me to be on the staff like assistant pastor, and they gave me charge of their midweek service, Wednesday night service. I would conduct it and teach and so on. And they asked me to do visitation and things like this. And it was considered a part-time thing, and I worked at another job. But God began to deal with us about starting a new congregation and a new ministry and so on. And so we're very careful with this because I don't know if you know, but in traditional churches, there's a lot of, what's the word I am looking for? A sense of competition, and especially somebody starting a new church, you know, and so on. But we were feeling this stirring and so on. And so finally, God confirmed it in a very real way. And so we stepped out and we shared with the pastor, you know, what was happening and so on. And I don't know, he may be on today. Ron Marr, down in Florida. Ron Marr, are you on today? We'd love to hear from you if you are. Hey, and so we talked to you about it, and you were just very positive about it. Yeah, man, and you all even took up an offering for us and loaned us chairs to get started. But here's one of the things that when we were struggling with this, there's a certain separation that's going to come. And one of the things that God showed me in this was the difference in being rightly related in the body of Christ and being properly related. Rightly related means that you have a right attitude, that you're not holding grudges and anger and so on against other members of the body of Christ. You have a right attitude. You're rightly related. But then this thing that was I'd never seen before was properly related, that you are with the right people at the right time that God wants you with. And a passage became real to me, and this is in 1 Corinthians 12, where it says that he, the Lord himself, Christ, who is the head of the church, that he has placed the members in the body as he has seen fit according to his wisdom, he placed. He put the thumb here. He put the finger here. And this little finger over here. He put the ears right here. Now, you know, I'm not as smart as he is. If I'd been putting together a human body, I might have put this thumb down where the little toe is. And I might have put an ear down where the knee is. And it would really been messed up. But he has placed the members of the body as he has seen fit, as it has pleased him in his wisdom. And not only did he design this physical body, which is a wonder, he also designs his body. He places the member where he wants them. And I will never forget, here's how it came to me. We were with these people, they were all great people. And the preaching was great, the singing was great, the music. We had some powerful experiences with God like we've never seen before, encounters with God there in that church, Crossroads Cathedral, out in, what was the name of that? Condola Point, New Brunswick. But there came a time where every time I'd go to church, I was irritated. I was irritated at everything, irritated at the singing, the preaching, everything, the praying. I'd leave there frustrated and irritated. And I begin to pray and say, God, I don't want to feel this way. What is wrong? Is this me? Is this them? God, what is wrong? What is going on? Help me, oh God, help me understand. And I heard the Holy Spirit. Now, this is the key. This is the key. Margaret, this is one answer. And this is not the full answer. Some of these things, they just have to be worked out and walked out in life. There's not a mechanical answer for everything. But this is something that can be very helpful. I heard the Holy Spirit very clearly say, there's nothing wrong with you, and there's nothing wrong with them. And he brought to mind a story I mentioned earlier about Elijah, when God told him to go down to the brook Cherith and drink from the brook, and the ravens would feed him. And later the brook dried up. And after the brook dried up, and there was no more water, there was no more refreshing, it was after that, then God spoke to him and said, hey, go down to Cherith. And so things got a little uncomfortable for Elijah before God spoke to him. And maybe that happens because maybe sometimes if we're too comfortable somewhere, we might be reluctant to move on. But this was my experience. I heard the Holy Spirit say, there's nothing wrong with you and there's nothing wrong with them. And then he brought this picture of Elijah and he said, but as far as you are concerned, the brook has dried up here. There is no more refreshing for you here because I have called you to move on. Hallelujah! And so we moved on, but we were still friends. We were still part of the body. And they blessed us. They gave us an offering. They loaned us chairs. And then the pastor was away, I think, went on vacation or something. He asked me to come over and fill in their midweek service. So there was still a trust there. We weren't competing. There was a trust there. We were another part of town anyway. But we were still a part of the same body, but we had more of a distant relationship now. You know, these five fingers, thumb and four fingers, have a very close relationship. They do all kinds of things together every day. In the body, they are very close. Now, they have a very distant relationship with the toes on my feet. They're part of the same body, but they have a distant relationship. And let me tell you, there are people in the body of Christ, you're supposed to have a distant relationship with them. And if you try to have a close relationship with somebody that God has ordained a distant relationship, you'll have all kinds of frustrations. You'll have a hard time being rightly related. But I want you to know, when you get together with those people, when you connect with those whom God wants you connected with, oh, there is a mutual life. There's mutual edification. There is joy. There's enjoyment being around those with whom God has called you to have a close working relationship with. So I would say, Margaret, start with Jesus. Oh, we've all got to be connected with Him. He's the head. He's the source. And then the second question is, God, who are those significant people? Not necessarily where do you want me to go to church, because you see, we don't go to church. We are the church. And so the second question would be, God, who are the significant people that you want me to nurture friendships and relationships with? So that's how I would answer your question, Margaret. First of all, nurture your relationship with Jesus, your fellowship, your union with Him. And then the next question is, Lord, who are the people that you want me to nurture friendship, fellowship, that you want me connected with, that you want me to be closely related to in the body of Christ? And I think that answers the question. Sue, did you have anything else you wanted to say? Okay, I want to pray for people. We are the body of Christ. There are gifts. There are gifts of the Holy Spirit distributed. And so let's pray right now. There are gifts of healings. There's gifts of working of miracles. There's words of wisdom, words of knowledge, all kinds of things, all kinds of gifts. You know, and there are even more what seems like natural gifts, gifts of serving, gifts of hospitality, talks about in Romans chapter 12. And yet they're called charismata. They use the same word, charisma. They flow out of the life of God. But I want to pray in closing right now. I just want to pray for you. Especially want to pray that you will just rest in Him. And just focus on, and just determine today, you're going to focus first of all on your relationship with Him. And you're going to trust Him to lead you, to be properly related, to be close related with those people He wants you to be joined together with. And there you find peace. You find fulfillment. You find your tribe. This is my tribe. These are the ones I belong to. Father, we thank you today that we are your body. We are your people. I ask you to help every person listening today to rest in you and that from this day they will be give priority to nurturing their relationship with you, their fellowship with you. Because that's what we've been called to. We have been called to you. We have been called together unto you. And we say, Lord, we're gathering together unto you this day. Everyone that is watching, we say, Lord, we're gathering together unto you. And I thank you, Lord, that you're going to use us to impact this planet before we leave this world or before you come back. Thank you, Lord. I believe you will use us to impact this planet because we are your body. We're a part of your body. And we thank you, Lord. And help every person, Lord, to rest in you, to nurture their friendship and relationship with you, recognizing that you are their kafala. You're their source of life for everything. And then, Lord, secondly, that you'll help us to understand where we fit and help us to flow, Lord, in the gifts you've given us interdependently with other members of the body of Christ. And God, thank you for revealing yourself all over this planet, all over this world. Thank you for making yourself known, Lord. And I pray for life, for health, for healing, for provision, for every person watching this telecast today, every person participating in this broadcast today, we thank you for it, Lord.
Now,
in Jesus' name, amen.
Before we go, would you turn around and would you mention about the other way, Eddie? Turn the other way.
Okay.
That August is fundraising month, and you're on the facts.
Okay, yeah. Hey, August, yes, August is fundraising month. You see it right here on the screen. We have some extra, you know, I want to say this. God has been so faithful. We have had no lack through this pandemic crisis. We are very, very thankful for that. God has been faithful, and we know He's going to be faithful, but we want to let you know about it, and then you can respond as you feel free to respond. During the month of August, we renew our streaming. In September, we renew our streaming, and it's $2,400 a year, and by paying it yearly rather than monthly, we save, I think it's around
$3,000.
$3,600. That much, Sue. Sue says $3,600.
I don't say it because I'm not on.
Yeah, Sue just says we save $3,600 by paying it once a year rather than paying it per month. And so it's $2,400. Also, we are having another open house, and we have people coming in, I know, from different parts of the country, and we have a special guest, a pastor from Arkansas is coming, and she's going to be presenting here, and also will be sharing on Sunday, and I'm trying to remember, what is her name, Sue?
Betty Gilliam.
Oh, Betty Gilliam, yes, Betty Gilliam, pastor, is going to be here. And so anyway, this we just wanted to share this with you and let you know, and so that you can be in faith with us for these extra expenses that's coming up and that we believe is going to come in during the month of August. And we just say right now in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you that every need is met according to your riches and glory. You are our kafali. You are our source. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Ellen Capozzi says, you answered my question. Thank you, Eddie. And Margaret, she says, that is a great help. Well, thank you all. This is what we want to do. We want to prepare you. We want to equip you and to help you to be all God has called you to be individually. And then also together, our efforts will be multiplied. God bless you. Look forward to seeing you Tuesday night. Sue is just reminding me, and Sue, your voice does pick up on my mic too, so it's okay. Every Monday, I am doing an hour of prayer, and you can connect with me. The easiest way to connect is just go to my Facebook page from 10 to 11. The prayer time has been very powerful. I am cooperating together in conjunction with the Breakout Prayer Network, which has a 24-hour radio, and they've started a special channel for for 24/7 prayer at this time. So you're welcome to join me on the radio, internet radio, bpnradio.com, or just go to my Facebook page at 10 o'clock in the morning at 10 a.m. in the morning, and we will be there.
And you will continue this teaching on Tuesday?
We are going to continue this teaching on What is Church Tuesday night, and we will be dealing with, and man, this is one I love, we'll be dealing with church as the temple of God, or as the sanctuary of God. The church is God's dwelling place on this earth. It's going to be exciting. So join us Tuesday night.
Okay. Do you want to sing anything while I'm putting up the...
Oh, sure. Yeah, we'll sing that chorus that we were singing. Praise the name of Jesus. Let's go to... Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. You're my rock, you're my fortress, you're my deliverer, in you will I trust. Praise the name of Jesus. Okay, I'm just going to scroll up a little bit here. We'll sing that again, but I just wanted to scroll up here so we could see a little better. Amen. Yes, praise the name of Jesus. And praise the name of Jesus. And you're my rock, and you're my fortress, you're my deliverer, in you will I trust. And praise the name of Jesus. The name of Jesus. Praise your name, Lord Jesus. You're my rock, you're my deliverer, you're my kafali, in you will I trust. Praise your name, Lord Jesus. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Lord, we lift up your name with our hearts full of praise. We exalt you, O Lord our God. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Lord, we lift up your name with our hearts full of praise. We exalt you, O Lord our God. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Lord, we lift up your name with our hearts full of praise. We exalt you, O Lord our God. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Lord, we lift up your name. Lord, we lift up your name with our hearts full of praise. We exalt you, O Lord.